Am I audible? Thanks, Pradipto. All right, let's get started. Thank you, everyone, for having me here. My name is Ruchi Singh. I work at Snapdeal as a software engineer in cloud and infrastructure team. And in this presentation, I'm going to talk about the journey that Snapdeal took from moving from a public cloud to its own private cloud, which is based on OpenStack. So what are we going to cover in the next 15 minutes? I'll tell you who we are, what do we do, to get you an idea on how, why we migrated our complete infrastructure from our public cloud to our own private cloud, why we migrated our 300 microservices, our more than 200 data stores and their dependent applications. Then I'll tell you how did we plan for that migration, what runtime gotchas we found and how did we fix them. And then we'll talk about some rollback strategies we figured out in case of failure. And after that, I'll share some key learnings. So Snapdeal, we are an e-commerce company. We are one of the largest e-commerce marketplace in India. We have more than 30 million products in our catalog. And we have more than 300,000 sellers who come to our platform to offer their products to the customer base we have. And in the last few years, we have seen a phenomenal growth in our business in the amount of transaction that we are doing on our platform. So this is we. Then what did we do regards to OpenStack? We have built our own private cloud. We call it Cirrus. So Cirrus is a private cloud based on OpenStack. We have more than 16 petabytes of storage that we have built for our infrastructure. We are running in our two different regions with more than 100,000 cores of capacity. Our networking is 40 gig from servers going to the spine nodes and 100 gig on the top of it. So very fast networking we have. And we are doing all of this with 100% automation and deploying everything through Ansible and some automation scripts that we have written on our own. And we just came out when we launched our private cloud. And we got to know that we are one of we are on the top 4% in the list of global OpenStack deployments in the world. So very happy to know that we are running in a very high core density racks of more than 3,500 cores per rack in a completely pod-based architecture. So this is our cloud. We call it Cirrus. So here's the story begin. I'll make sure that you guys don't sleep. So because I'm going to tell you our story that how did we migrate our complete infrastructure from AWS, which we used to use earlier, and how we migrated to how we migrated this to our private cloud. So before starting anything, we always do this. We always make a checklist, kind of checklist before starting anything big or small. So the first item in our checklist was understand why you are migrating. We also did this. We figured out that why we were migrating, why we were, what made us to start such a big project on such a big scale. And we also saw that where we were lagging behind, where we also saw from a business point of view that were we spending a lot in our in the terms of our infrastructure need. We also were we having any performance issues, any security kind of issues, and many more. So after that, we having strong reasons and factors that we had to do it, and we had to we were ensured that we had to migrate our infrastructure. Strong planning was needed for this project, as it includes lots of risks and failures, because this is the project where you can fail, where you can, when you are migrating all your services in the new data center, you have to ensure the compatibility between the applications and the new data center. So strong planning was needed for this project also. After that, regaining knowledge, gaining knowledge about the infrastructure was the main and huge task for us. Some applications may be decade old, so we decided to have a complete knowledge about our infrastructure first, about like how many, we figured out that how many services are currently running in our existing infrastructure, how many data stores they are using and how they are communicating with each other. So we figured out that how we can basically learn everything about our existing environment before starting migrating from a different cloud to the different cloud. After that, risk reduction and ensuring compatibility was also the main concern for us before starting this. So extended or unplanned downtimes, if I talk about risks, extended or unplanned downtimes were the main risk that we had to recognize them, and we try to mitigate them. To what extent our business can tolerate these risks will depend on the importance of the application you are migrating at a particular point of time. So similar calculations was needed to apply on the risk of data loss. The more important sensitive data, the more safeguards needed to be in place to prevent its loss during migration. So we thought of some kind of disaster recovery processes, some kind of extensive backups that can be worked during migration. Then for all applications, for ensuring compatibility, we thought of try our migration on our staging environment before doing it directly on production, so that we can ensure the compatibility between our applications, all our applications, and the new data center, and all these things like networking and all these things. The fourth list item was network particularities and limiting latencies. In terms of network, we had to ensure that that each service should have a predetermined space in the new network. And for this, it is important to consider all the aspects of firewall settings, domains, and trust certificates to ensure the full compatibility with the new network. If I talk about limiting latencies, so controlling latency was the important and main concern for us before starting this. Especially for those services which were business critical. So knowing exactly which all services work together and their frequency of their communication can work in terms of controlling latency. And last but not the least, getting everyone on board was also the huge task for us, because we are a big company. We have more than 5,000 employees in our company, and we have more than 70 components running in our company. So we had to tell everyone that we are starting such a big project, and you all had to be with us during this project. So getting on board was also the huge task for us. So this is the main items in our checklist we listed down before starting such a big project. After that, why did we build our private cloud? What was the main reasons that made us to start such a big project? So cost was one of the major factor. Like I said before, that we were running in a hyper growth mode, and as our business grew, our infrastructure requirements also continued to grow, and our bill on the public cloud was phenomenal. So we had to find ways to control that bill or to reduce that one. It was very clear to us that at a certain scale, public cloud stopped being cost effective. They are okay when you are just starting up, but at an inflection point, you need to start some kind of alternatives. And for us, it was building our own cloud. But how did we make it cost effective? Snapdeal Cloud is completely running on open source technologies. We did some analysis on some enterprise technologies like VMware and all. And we also calculated the operational cost of managing our data center. And we came up with this plan that we had to do this, and we can. We also have a small in-house team to build, automate, and control and manage our data center platform. The next big reason for us to do so, besides cost, was performance and security. We wanted to get more performance from our infrastructure side, and in public cloud, you are restricted because you are kind of in a shared tenant architecture, and there is only so much performance that public cloud offer. They can offer you more, but again, on a very high cost. But it is restrictive for the large scale that we were looking for. So by building our own cloud, we are now able to optimize it for our self-use. We are able to put some advanced security appliances, some DDoS preventions, intrusion detections into our data center. So definitely a step up into the security that public cloud offers. And lastly, data sovereignty. As I said, that we are an e-commerce, an ecosystem. So we also have a digital wallet, which required us to make sure that all the money-related data that we used to store in that application remains within the boundaries of India. And at that time, when we were using our public cloud, they did not have any region in India at that time. So for at least that particular application to be hosted within the boundaries of India, we had to look for some alternative reasons to host that particular application and to to keep that data within the boundaries of India. So these were the four main reasons because of which we built our own private cloud: lower cost, better performance, security and compliance, and data sovereignty. So we started, our migration, we started this by gaining the knowledge about our existing environment. We found that we have more than 300 microservices running currently. We have more than 200 data stores, which includes MySQL, MongoDB, Aerospike, Redis, Elasticsearch, RabbitMQ, ActiveMQ, and many more. We figured that how these services are being deployed. Are they being deployed manually or through some automation? For our deployment purposes, we use Chef. So firstly, for those services which were deploying manually, we onboarded all those services to Chef and made them deploying through automation, so that in our new infrastructure, there will be no manual deployments or no manual thing we have to do. So we first onboarded, we first make all our applications deploying automatically. After that, these were the after planning steps we did. Earlier in our private public cloud, there is no central place where an ops person or a dev person can find that, okay, in this particular server, this particular application is running. We have, like I said before, that we have 300 microservices. So what we do, we actually listed down all our services in a central place. And in that case, in our case, it is a YAML file. So what we did, we actually listed down all the services in a YAML file, all the critical informations for a particular application that we needed, like on which port that particular service used to run, which all applications it used to communicate with each other, what all databases it uses. So we listed down all these information in our YAML file, and that YAML file also acts as an infrastructure as code in our case. So we actually using that YAML file to apply some infrastructure as code technologies in our infrastructure. After that, we divided all our services in some small groups so that we can migrate them together. Those services which were tightly coupled, used to communicate frequently, so that we can basically reduce our latency issues. So we divided all these services in smaller groups. We also made a dependency graph to facilitate our migration, so that we can have a visual type of thing where we can see that these services we already migrated and these all services we have to migrate. We kept all our data stores in our replication mode so that we can basically avoid the data corruption issues or data loss issues. So we were keeping all our data stores in the sync mode, including MySQL, Aerospike, and MongoDB. And we migrated all tightly coupled services together according to our business flows. Like, we have three main flows: seller flow, buyer flow, and supply chain flow. So we migrated all those services according to these flows. After that, planning is the most important key for every project, but there are always some runtime gotchas that you get only at runtime, like some runtime exceptions we get every time. So we also did some mistakes. There were some scenarios. One of them, was when we were in the middle of our migration, we used to put some security checks or some security groups in our old cloud on the ELB to serve the traffic to the actual servers. And there were some services which used to communicate frequently, and one of them was running in the public cloud. And when we were migrating our first service, so traffic was supposed to go on public cloud according to our code that we were written, because the old service was running in the old cloud, but we forgot to place the security groups there, and there was no traffic coming on the public cloud servers where the actual service was running. So we had to check all these checks before migrating, before serving the actual traffic in the production environment. The second one was we used to keep our databases in sync so that no data corrupt things happens. But there were some scenarios where our data has been had been corrupted, and we were getting some serious exceptions in our application. So in that case, we took the data and we dumped that data. We dumped that data to the new servers. But there was kind of pain for doing so. So we had to make sure that all our database servers are in sync correctly so that no data loss or no data corruption thing happened. After that, another scenario was when we were migrating one of our service, the launched machines were not able to handle the load. So we had to extend our infrastructure at runtime. So to avoid these type of risks, we had to ensure that the number of machines needed for that application to handle the node. So we had to ensure earlier before starting this migration. And to avoid all these issues, monitoring of your infrastructure is one of the most important things you had to do. We were doing monitoring of every individual system as well as our applications. In our case, order count was the critical thing that we had to ensure that our order count does not drop during our migration activities. So we use Isinga and EFK stack for our monitoring purposes, and we used to monitor our infrastructure every time when we used to do any migration activity. There are some rollback strategies we also figured out. So traffic redirection, we actually figured out that in case of failure, we had to ensure that within milliseconds, we can redirect the traffic to the old servers, to the old cloud, so that we cannot have the exceptions in our new cloud. After that, database resync, it is also the most important thing when we use to migrate our service. What we do is basically we handling it to QA, we used to keep that database in a read mode so that we could actually avoid some exceptions. We were facing them. So we also set some cooling periods. We don't shut down our old servers. That was around a month until we found that service is running flawlessly in our new data center. These are the technical tools we were using for our application, for our data center migration. Our YAML file, which also acts as a infrastructure as code in our case. We were using dendrite for our service discovery. We wrote Nerve and Synapse code for this. We use SaltStack and Chef as an orchestration tools. We use Git and Jenkins for our CI/CD pipelines, and we also wrote some automation scripts.
Ruchi, sorry to be rude, but we have to stop here. You're over your time.
Sure.
Can you just recap quickly, and we can. And you can talk to the people in the booth maybe as outside in the corridor.
Yeah, so actually I had only 15 minutes to talk about our migration, but there are a lot to know about that. So those who actually wants to know more about our migration, I'm around. You can talk to me anytime. I just want to share some key learnings. It just takes 5 minutes or say 2 minutes. Okay. Plan about your migration. Understand your services, your infrastructure better before starting your migration. We also created a live dependency graph to see that. Don't migrate as it is. Fix the problems that you have, and after that, migrate that application to the new cloud. And ensure that you set the strict naming conventions, and make sure that all launched services are registered with all your orchestration tools. and automate and monitor everything before starting such a big project on such a big scale?
Thanks, Ruchi. We'll have to stop here.
Sure.
Ruchi and a colleague Aditya are also going to be around tomorrow at the Isinga camp. If you're planning to attend, they will be talking about how they've used Isinga for monitoring. And of course, Ruchi is also going to be around at the conference, so we can take more questions.
Okay. Thank you.